93 centimetres tall. I weigh 85 kilograms. That gives me a body mass index of 25. That's slightly overweight. Got a 99 centimetre chest, an 84 centimetre waist, and a 79 centimetre inside leg. Size 42 feet. A 42 centimetre collar, wedding ring, size Q, hat size 7 1/4. My eyes are somewhere in between brown and green, so I usually say that they're hazel. As you can see, my hair is mousy brown, although my hairdresser says that's a dark blonde. About 12 years ago, I started getting eczema for the first time on this foot here. And now I still get it on this foot and on this finger and on this knuckle. About the same time as the eczema appeared, I started getting hay fever. And after a couple of years of saying, but it can't be hay fever, because I don't get hay fever, I eventually went to the doctor and found out that actually I do get hay fever. I've developed an allergy to tree pollen and I get hay fever in the spring rather than the summer. Along with the hay fever came oral allergy syndrome, which means I can no longer eat hard fruit like pears and apples and peaches. 3 years ago, I noticed that I was doing this with my mobile phone to read it. And 2 years ago, I went to the optician. And I've been wearing glasses to read ever since. I have a mild obsessive compulsion that means that I will go back to double, triple, and even quadruple check that the back door is locked before I leave the house. I prefer coffee to tea. I prefer red wine to white wine. I prefer gin to whiskey. I prefer sparkling water to still. I prefer plain chocolate to milk chocolate. I don't like olives, or cucumber, or celery, or marmite, or peanut butter. I'm blood type O rhesus positive. My resting heart rate is 67 beats per minute. My blood pressure is 127 over 77. I was born on the 27th of April, 1969, at 2:30 in the morning, and I weighed 3.2 kilograms. And those are the facts. Undisputable physical facts about me. And that's where this project started, really, with a fascination with this physiology and a curiosity as to where in this matter my personality lies. I've read that over the course of a 7-year period, my body will replace every single one of its cells. So if I'm not physically the same body I was when I was a 14-year-old boy, where in this body do my memories of being that 14-year-old boy live? And I'm curious about what the memories are of, you know, the experiences themselves, I suppose. And sometimes I wonder if I'd made a different decision one day in, let's say, 1989, would I be somewhere else tonight? Would I be a different person? When I finished school, I carried on living at home with my mum for a couple of years, and I got a series of crap jobs in a bar, in a call centre, in a warehouse. And for that 2-year period, my social life revolved almost entirely around my group of mates. We were all lads, all about the same age, and we did everything together. We went to the pub together, we played computer games together, we played Dungeons & Dragons together. A lot, actually. We watched films together, we watched football together, we went shopping together, we hung around in each other's houses, listening to music and talking about girls together. And at some point in that 2-year period, my mum said to me, when you get older and you come to write your autobiography, you will call this chapter Waiting for the Lads. And ever since my mum said that to me, I've had this idea in the back of my head about what I would call this chapter of my autobiography, even whilst I'm still living it. Over the course of this project, I spoke to a lot of different men. And I asked them about the times in their lives where something changed, the times in their lives where they understood something differently. I asked them what they would call the chapters in the unwritten books of their life stories. So, given that that's our subject matter, at some point this evening, I'm going to have to talk about pubs. And that's fine by me, because I think pubs are fantastic. Now, I know a lot of people like pubs, or bars, as you call them over here, but not everyone realises how important pubs are. And why are they so important? Well, think about it. You're in a strange town, you've got a couple of hours to kill, you don't know anybody, maybe you're waiting for a train or a meeting, what can you do? You can go to a pub, can't you? Any pub at all, and you will be made welcome, because pub is short for public house. Pubs are houses where any member of the public, as long as they're old enough and they haven't been banned, is welcome. So any pub you go into on any evening, whether it is in a strange town or just at the bottom of your street, could potentially be home to almost anyone in the country, just for that night. I know usually, though, you go to a local pub with your friends, don't you? I understand that, and that's really nice because no one has to worry about cleaning up the next day. Everyone can drink whatever they want, and you can have a chat, you can tell each other jokes, talk about your problems, get them sorted out, generally spend some quality time together. Very nice. But some nights you don't really want to see your mates, do you? I mean, you see them all the time as it is. To be honest, they're getting a bit boring. And actually, in this day and age, it's important, it's so busy, to have some quality time for yourself, isn't it? And that's all right in the pub as well. You can turn up on your own, you can nurse your drink, you can read the newspaper. In England, they tie them to big sticks of wood so you don't steal them. Or you could bring something on your phone, you know, or you could go and play a game, couldn't you? A quiz machine or a fruit machine, or you could go and have a game of pool. If you play pool in an English pub, you'll probably end up playing the rule, winner stays on. So you'll find yourself playing pool with someone you don't know, maybe a stranger, and you're going to have to talk to that person. Pubs encourage us to talk to strangers. And it doesn't have to be over a game of pool. It could be just at the bar. You just go up to the bar, park yourself, buy yourself a drink, get talking to the person next to you. Now, I know, not everyone's happy talking to strangers, are they? Some people are a bit shy, a bit nervous, but that's all right, because pubs sell booze. Booze relaxes you, makes you a bit more interesting, makes the other person a bit more interesting. Suddenly the conversation is flowing, makes some people positively garrulous apparently, and it also makes some people more attractive. And some of these strangers you meet in the pub, you might get to go home and have sex with. So let's just recap. Pubs let you spend quality time with your friends, they let you have quality time on your own. They encourage you to meet strangers who you might get to go and have sex with. And sometimes sex leads to reproduction and babies, doesn't it? Surely these are three of the most important things in life, aren't they? So I propose a toast to the glory that is the great British pub, that in encouraging people to procreate helps to ensure the survival of the species. But more important than that, makes life worth living. Cheers. So this is a story set in a pub. You are 15 years old. You're sitting in the back garden of a pub with your dad and some of your dad's friends. This is a pub garden that you're very familiar with because it's the sort of pub garden that parents are very happy to let their children play in. There's a big L-shaped lawn, and around the lawn there are flower beds with shrubs and a line of trees. Beyond the trees, there is a 2-metre-high brick wall all the way around the garden. There's nearly always a game of football or cricket or both going on in this pub garden, but on this particular afternoon, there's just you, your dad, and your dad's friends. A little boy comes out of the back door of the pub, and he starts playing in the garden, and that's not unusual, so you don't pay him any more attention. Sometime later, a man comes out of the back door of the pub. He's not wearing a shirt, and you can see that he's got tattoos and a ponytail. He's looking for something, and because you notice that he's looking for something, you start looking around for whatever it is as well. And you both notice it at the same time. The little boy is now playing on top of the 2-metre-high brick wall, and you know that the drop on the other side is even further down onto pavement. The man starts walking over towards the little boy, and he calls over to your table. Are you not fucking blind? Can't you see there's a little boy playing on top of this fucking wall? Silence. Your dad looks over for the first time to see what's going on. He calls back, he's not our responsibility. Silence. The man gets the boy down off the wall and starts heading back to the door to the pub. I've got a good mind to come over there and smash that fucking pint glass in your fucking face. Silence. The man disappears into the pub, taking the little boy with him. Your dad says, it comes to something when you're talking about child safety and you're threatening to smash a pint glass in somebody else's face. And then the conversation picks up about whatever it was about before these things happened. And you sit there confused. Because your dad was right, that guy was out of order having a go at you when he let the little boy out of his sight. But your dad was wrong. That little boy was on his own. Surely he was your responsibility. And this is the first time that you realise that your dad can be wrong. So these are my top 10 favourite facts. Number one, you're more likely to die playing bowls than any other sport. Two, human beings share 48% of their DNA with cabbages. Three, in the 1960s, the US spent millions of dollars developing a pen that would write in zero gravity. The Russians used a pencil. Four, if you laid out all of your nerves and capillaries and veins end to end, they would stretch all the way to the moon and back again. I know the Earth has got 7 moons, I'm just talking about the moon we all refer to as the moon. The 7 moons thing, that's not one of the facts. It is a fact, but it's not one of my top 10 facts. It's like a sub, it's 4A, if you like, it's a sub fact. Five, relative to its size, the wild boar produces the most semen per ejaculation of any species. 2 litres in one go. It's like 4 pints, isn't it? Six, coconuts kill more people in the world each year than sharks do. There's usually 6 or between 6 and 12 people killed by shark each year, but there's always at least 150 coconut-related fatalities. During an average lifetime, a man will spend 3,350 hours removing 8.4 metres of beard. The average person swallows 8 spiders a year. 17% of people are left-handed, and the same figure is true of chimpanzees and gorillas. 10. Termites eat through wood twice as fast if they're listening to Van Halen. You are 58 years old. You've been divorced now for 2 years, and you've also been through your transitional relationship, and it's a good thing in both cases that the relationship is over. You've got a new job, it's better paid, and you've enjoyed the work more. You'd go as far as to say you've got a whole new lease of life. You decide that you're going to finally get around to doing some of those things you've been meaning to do just for yourself for years now. Top of your list is to learn Spanish. So you find some evening classes and you go along to the first lesson, where you discover that the teacher is absolutely gorgeous. She's so good looking, it makes you nervous. Halfway through the first lesson you say something stupid by mistake. You didn't mean it, but she disagrees and you end up having an argument with her about something you didn't even mean to say in the first place. So the second week you calm yourself down before you go in. Just take a deep breath and you get on much better. The two of you are the two oldest people at the class. She's in her early 40s, maybe 15 years younger than you. And she sees you as an ally for that reason. And you've got a lot of stuff in common, family stuff, medical history stuff, you know. Getting on great. You're also really enjoying learning Spanish. So after the third lesson, with no ulterior motive whatsoever, you ask her if she would be interested in doing some personal tuition. She says she would, what a good idea, and she invites you over to her house the following week. So this first private Spanish lesson is just that, it's a private Spanish lesson. But what's important about it is it moves you into her domestic orbit. You go to her house, you see what books she's reading, you see what music she likes, and all of this gives you more conversational ammunition. Getting on really well now. So the following week, you decide to bite the bullet and ask her if she would like to go for dinner. She says she would, what a lovely idea, and you arrange a time and a place. So a week later, you're getting ready to go out. But the problem is, you don't know if this is a date or not. You don't know if it's just two friends meeting for some food, or if there's more to it than that. 2 hours later, sitting opposite her in the restaurant, I'm pretty sure there is more to it than that. And when you get home with her after the restaurant, the evening goes on to become very pleasant very quickly. And this is the start of the most intense, the most physical, the most sexual relationship of your entire life. You speak to each other on the phone 3 or 4 times a week. She emails you 3 or 4 times a day. And you have to reply to each of her emails individually. You can't save it all up and just send them one email back in the evening. You have to have a proper electronic conversation. 2 months into the relationship, she goes away on holiday for a week. It was arranged before you were around. But she phones you every day that she's away. And some of these phone conversations last for 3 hours. You've never had a 3-hour phone conversation before in your life. Sexually, it is fantastic. I mean, it's quite tiring, actually. But fantastic, no complaints. But 3 months into the relationship, you find yourself temporarily between jobs. But you notice that you don't spend any of your free time pursuing any of those other things on your list of things you really want to do just for yourself. You just dedicate all of your energy to the relationship. Even though what you have also noticed is that when the two of you do anything together, it's always her who decides where and when. And you've also noticed that when you're with her these days, you don't really act like yourself anymore. You act the way you think she wants you to act. This is a trait you recognise in yourself from previous relationships. It's not something you like. Thinking about it rationally, you think it's probably for the best, for all concerned, if you end it. So you make the decision. And the next time you see her, you finish it. But the trouble is, neither of you actually want it to end. And one evening the following week, after class, she restarts it. And then 2 weeks later, she finishes it. For good this time. So it's messy and complicated at the end. You've only known each other for about 6 months, but this is the most depressed you ever remember being. You have this one very clear memory from quite early on in your relationship where one evening she told you how she used to be a model And she showed me some photographs, some professional photographs she'd had taken when she was in her early 20s. And you remember sitting looking at these photographs and thinking back then, she was so beautiful that if you'd met her in real life, you wouldn't even have dared to speak to her. And yet, here she was a few short years later, pursuing you as much as you were pursuing her, and when she got hold of you, pretty much using you as a sex object. As the depression begins to fade, you realise that actually, this relationship has done you the world of good. Your confidence is at an all-time high. You're the happiest you've ever been going and starting a conversation with a woman you've not spoken to before. And you're the happiest you've ever been starting new relationships. And these new relationships, turns out there's going to be quite a few of them. Thanks very much. In the next few years. Some people think you can tell a lot about someone's personality if you know what blood type they are. It's called blood profiling. It's very popular in Japan, apparently. I'm blood type O, and that means that I am ambitious, flexible, and go-getting. I'm an opportunistic survivor. Although, romantically, my blood makes me fickle and needy. He also suggests that I should eat a lot of meat protein because of the high levels of stomach acid it gives me, which is a shame because I've been vegetarian for 26 years. Other people think that graphology can tell you a lot about someone's personality. Analysis of my handwriting tells us that I have a relaxed and balanced attitude. I'm friendly, honest, sympathetic, and affectionate. I have a desire to be close to other people and to have an identity within a group or a gang. But I have problems with self-discipline, apparently, and mood swings that make me unreliable. I'm needy, and I'm inclined to feel inferior, resentful. And although I also think that my word should be final. Most of that doesn't sound like me at all, I don't think. I mean, I recognise some of it. I recognise the desire to be close to other people and to have an identity in a group or a gang. Because if I look back at my life, I can see I have always had a gang. Not the same gang, obviously, but always a close group of friends around me. And I do like to think about my friends in groups or as individuals. And sometimes I think about how I can know two different people really well. But those two people have never even met each other. And I wonder if those two people know two different versions of me. And I like to think about all of my friends and acquaintances in a big diagram in my head. And I like to move people from one category to another as relationships change and develop. You know, I have a category for my work friends, the people I actually get on with. And then I have a subcategory within that for work mates. These are people I can get on with at work, but I wouldn't choose to go to the pub with them because I know that after 20 minutes the conversation would just dry up and it would all get a bit awkward. I've got a category for my school friends, people I've stayed in touch with since school and who I do get on with. Let's subcategory within this, which is Friends Reunited contacts. People who got in touch with me through the Friends Reunited website when that was operational, and they sent me a message and said, "Hi there, remember me? What are you doing?" And I thought, that's really nice. So I've emailed them back and said, "Hi there, this is what I'm doing, what about you?" And I've never heard from them again because they quickly realised they're not actually very bothered. I've got a category for couples friends, you know, for double dates, and a category which is my girlfriend's friends. These are people I like and who I look forward to seeing, but I would never arrange to see them on my own without my girlfriend being there, because that would just be weird. A subcategory which is my girlfriend's older friends. These are people my girlfriend knows from other aspects of her life, and most of them are pre-me. And some of those people, when we see them, they don't talk to my girlfriend like she's the woman she's grown up to be now. They talk to her like the girl she was when they first got to know her, and I find that a bit fucking annoying. So, friends, partners. Now, some people generally pass through this category on their way to other categories as I get to know them better, but there's one person in this category who is staying in this category because I don't like her very much. And I don't get with my friend as well as I used to now he's going out with her. So I go around to his house and she's always around there, and I'm trying to talk to him and she's saying things like, "Well, we think this, don't we, darling?" This is friends of friends, people I would like to get to know better. A couple of them I have the suspicion that maybe they don't like me quite as much as I like them. But the main problem is simply that I don't have their mobile number, so I can't phone them up and invite them to stuff, and I have to wait till our mutual friend invites us both to the same thing so I can see them again. Because of course I can't add them on friend on Facebook, because if they ignore the friend request it would be crushing and this is the guy who would like to be much better friends with me, but I don't really have time to be friends with him. This guy I do have time for. This is my friend who I really like and all of my other friends can't stand, so I always have to see him on his own. this is ex-friends, you know, still mates, we still get on, we're just not as close as we used to be. It's like our friendship went straight in at number one and then drifted off down the charts. We still see each other maybe once a year, and we always have a good time when we see each other, and at the end of the night we always say we must do this again sooner next time, but it's always about a year before we see each other again. This is my special friend. Now, my special friend is a woman, but it's completely platonic. She's like a sister, the sister I never had. And she doesn't know a lot of my other friends very well, so that's helpful. There's some distance there, so I can confide in her. This one is my children's friend's parents. It's just really complicated. But then it gets even more complicated. The last two categories overlap with three or four or five other categories, and this may be maybe there's one person in each of those categories. So there's ex-girlfriends. Now, a couple of people in this category I am genuinely close friends with now. But a couple of people, maybe I did just stay in touch with them because I think they never quite got over me and they still fancy me a bit, and that's quite good for my ego. Another subcategory, which is flings and one-night stands. You know, so the friend who I got drunk with and had sex with one night, you know. But it's fine now, we can talk about it, we can laugh about it. Well, not laugh about it. You know what I mean, we're absent. Or the girl who I went home with after the office Christmas party, and then the next day we saw each other on the stairs and we were like, oh, we saw each other naked last night, are we going to talk about it? No, we're not, and we've never mentioned it since. And then this last category, on this level, overlaps with, five or six other categories, and there's perhaps just one person in each of those little overlaps, and these are my closest friends. The people I can rely on, people I turn to for advice because I know they won't take the piss out of me too badly for whatever scrape I've got myself into. So, these people, I mean, some of them I see every week, some of them I see twice a year, but it's always like I saw them yesterday. I've got all of this worked out on graph paper in different colour pens, and then I've got an extra layer drawn on tracing paper, which is Twitter, and another layer of tracing paper, which is Facebook, because I think it's important to keep those separate. But I think it's important to keep it catalogued and accurate and up to date. The men I spoke to told me all sorts of different stories. And with most of the stories they told me, I could see some parallel in my own life. But with one or two of them, the story they told me was just completely beyond my experience. It is January 1945. You are 19 years old. You are flight sergeant observer in a two-man crew bow fighter bomber. That means you're the navigator, and the air gunner, and the radio operator, and the reconnaissance photographer. You're only 19 years old, but you can navigate this plane using the stars in the nighttime sky. And on this particular night time, your plane is in the sky somewhere over occupied Holland. And on this particular night time, your plane is on fire. Neither you nor the pilot have done a parachute jump before, but you're going to have to bail out. You are first out of the plane, the parachute opens almost instantly, and as you look down towards the ground, you see that the packet of cigarettes that you did have wedged into your boots has come free, and you watch as your cigarettes fall away from you and down towards the ground, and for one moment, you are pissed off about that. Then the pilot falls past you, and you watch him, and you wait for his parachute to open. And it never does. and your training kicks in. Your knees bend, you fall, you roll, you're back on your feet, you gather your parachute into your chest, you run across the field and stuff the parachute into a ditch to hide it, then you run out onto a country road where you see a small boy just standing watching you. You also see a bike leaning against the wall, and even though you don't know where you are, you think, I'm going to steal that bike. But just then a man comes down the road, he's also on a bike, and he indicates to you, because he doesn't speak any English, he indicates to you that you should get on that bike and you should follow him. So you do. He leads you to a farmhouse, the farmer pulls you off the bike, pushes you down a corridor, opens a cupboard door, pushes you into the cupboard, he says one word to you, and the word he says is quiet. And then he closes the cupboard door and leaves you standing in darkness, listening to the sound of your heart beating, which is beating a lot louder than you think a man who has just been told to be quiet should let his heart be beating. And then you hear a knock on the farmhouse door. You hear the farmhouse door opened, and you hear the farmer let in the Nazi soldiers, looking for you. You hear them come down the corridor, past your cupboard, and go through into the rest of the house. You hear them searching every other room in the farmhouse, and then you hear the soldiers outside of your cupboard in the corridor again. And then you hear them leave. And sometime after that, you don't know how long, the farmer opens the cupboard door and lets you out. You've been picked up by the resistance. They take your dog tags from you and they give you a forged identity card with your photograph on it and with the name Jan van der Plug. They give you a badge that reads Dufstam. Dufstam means deaf and dumb. Because your cover story is going to be that Jan van der Plug is a deaf and dumb tailor from the north of Holland making his way cross country by bicycle. Because you're pretending to be deaf, you have to ignore it if anyone speaks to you from behind. Even if they're shouting at you, even if you know they are armed because they are on a roadblock, you have to just keep cycling, pretend you can't hear them, and pray they don't shoot. And in this way, you move cross-country from one safe house to another. And in the safe houses, the resistance families that hide you, they feed you from the meagre rations that they get given every week, which is usually just some potatoes and some fat. They make puddings out of mashed up tulip bulbs, and tea and coffee made out of dried privet leaves. Although, what the difference between dried privet leaf tea and dried privet leaf coffee is, you never actually understand. You're standing in an alcove off a living room in a house in the north of Holland. The alcove is curtained off from the living room, and in the living room, the police officer, whose house this is, he's sitting drinking whiskey with a Nazi officer. Because the policeman's cover is that he is very friendly with the occupying forces, so they're quite often popping around for a quick drink. Standing next to you in the alcove is a resistance soldier who is reputed actually to be a resistance assassin. You heard that one night he got on board a night train and executed six Nazi officers in their beds. But you can't ask him about this because he doesn't really speak any English. He has picked up a few words of English listening to the BBC World Service band night. He particularly likes Roy Fox and his orchestra. And in fact, he decides to take this opportunity, whilst the two of you are alone together, to try out the few words of English that he does have on you. He nudges you and he says, "Take it away, boys." And he starts to laugh. And you can't help it, you start to laugh as well, and he likes that. So he says it again, but a bit louder this time. "Take it away, boys," and you become hysterical with fear and laughter, and you have to cram your fist into your mouth in an attempt not to be heard, and by some miracle, the Nazi officer doesn't hear you. He finishes his whiskey, and he gets up and leaves. You are 20 years old. You've made it out of occupied Holland, through Allied France and back to Britain. You've been through interrogation and debriefing and a medical. You've lost about 10 kilograms. Your fiancé has believed you to be missing in action, presumed dead, for 3 months. You send her a telegram the first opportunity you get. The telegram reads, "Hello, Toots. Arrived in London in the pink. Meet me tomorrow, Glasgow Central Station, 10 a.m. You make it home to Scotland. And over the next 2 months, you find out two things. You find out that the man who forged your identity card and the man who took your photograph to go on it were both executed for helping men like you. And you find out that you're a member of a club. It's called the Caterpillar Club. And you're a member because you were able to save your own life using a caterpillar silk parachute. They send you a membership badge that you will choose to wear under your lapel in the future, a small brass badge in the shape of a caterpillar. Over the next few years, you lose touch with everyone in Holland who helped you. And you never talk about this story to your friends or even to your family. Until one afternoon, years later, when there is a knock at your front door. You happen to be at home because you're recovering from an operation. Your wife goes to answer the door, and although she's never met the man who's standing there, she knows instantly who he is. He's the farmer who hid you on the first night you landed in Holland. He's a successful businessman now, and he's been in London for meetings, and he's been in touch with the Royal Air Force, the RAF, and he's asked them for your address. For reasons that you will never bother to investigate, the RAF told him that you were dead. But he told the RAF that that was impossible, because if you were dead, he would know. And so he took from the RAF what they thought was your last known address, he's got on a train, and he's come and found you. You haven't seen each other for over 30 years, so you invite him in for a cup of tea. What do men do? They play computer games. They read the newspaper. They watch the football. They take the piss. They take the bins out. They argue the toss. They take things too seriously. They don't take things seriously enough. They work 12-hour shifts. They listen to music on headphones. They ride bikes with no lights. They ride bikes with no hands. They down pints. They shotgun cans, they point brick walls, they put shelves up, they read on the toilet, they stop pissing halfway through, because they can. They drive too fast, they drive whilst drunk, they get indignant about stuff. They fight, they watch other men fight, they open jam jars. They cook, they garden, they look out for their mates. They run to the shops, they love their families, they flirt, they keep phone conversations short. They imagine being able to fly. They imagine being able to turn invisible. They fix things. They get depressed. They feel lonely. They eat some toast. They bullshit. They brag. They bully. They support the underdog. They sit in the sauna. They commit adultery. They wonder who they are. They worry about money. They act on impulse, they forget about it. They moan when they're ill, they torture people, they show off, they fix cars, they help strangers who are lost. They struggle to accept air loss. They try on their first condom when they're on their own, so that when they have to try one on when they're with someone else, they'll know what they're doing. They remember road numbers. They look at themselves in the mirror, they like what they see. They buy gadgets, they avoid work, they nap, they alphabetize, they make compilation tapes and CDs and playlists. They download, they drink too much, they eat too much, they get rowdy, they get leery, they get frisky, they do the maths. They walk around like they own the place. They try to guess what you are thinking. They go out of their way. They go to sleep during arguments, if they're allowed to. They build homes. They piss in the sink. They piss in the streets. They piss in the shower, they piss in the fireplace, they piss in the wardrobe, they piss in the empty pint glass that they keep next to their bed for just such an eventuality. They get their hair cut, they have a lie-in, they go down the gym, they phone their mum, they get unnecessarily competitive. They pick their noses whilst driving, they think about things rationally, they say it's not a problem when it clearly is. They play pool, they wear vests, they hang around in gangs, they go for walks on their own. They cut the lawn, they wash the car, they watch films, they buy magazine, they build models, they beat their wives, they collect stamps, they draw pictures, they refuse to ask for directions when they are lost. They stick to the timetable, they sit with their knees too far apart. They say, that's not what I mean. They show you what they are talking about. They video everything. They make you watch it later on. They walk the dog. They posture, they fuck, they get angry with other road users, they look at pornography, they worry about the size of their penis. They take holidays together, they forget birthdays, they put their hands on a girl's hips as they brush past her in the office. They die first. They say, while you're down there, they stub their toes, they wear overalls, they write lists. They miss buses, they take taxis, they stick the knife in, they predict the weather, they make maps, they start wars, they sign treaties, they invent things, they ejaculate, they reminisce, they pick their teeth, they give farts marks out of 10. They try to fuck women in the arse and then pretend that it was an accident. They chair committees, they make plans, they sometimes cry. They say, if I were you, and they give you advice. They try to wash blood out of clothes using hot water. They start religions, they get a bit sweaty. They grow beards, they shave them off. They get erections on public transport and secretly enjoy it. They do press-ups, they drink meths, they feel responsible. They miss their girlfriends, they whinge, they rehearse arguments in their heads. They daydream, they skim stones over the lake. They throw their kids up in the air. They refuse to lend their tools. They straighten their ties, they straighten their hair. They play with kids' toys, they jiggle their bollocks. They stare at women's breasts. They try not to stare at women's breasts quite so much. They drink themselves into temporary impotence. They try to solve your problem even though you haven't asked them to. They bang on the side of the van. They shout during arguments. They swear at inanimate objects. They swear at strangers in the street. They swear at referees. They have sex in public toilets. They govern. They say, you like that, don't you? They make money. They travel, they wear jumpers, they sing, they drink coffee, they fall in love, they go to clubs, they pay for sex, they hurt your feelings, they throw cushions, they sail remote control boats, they make women pregnant, they wink, they wank, they shake hands, they play golf, they pat each other on the back, they give sideways one-arm man hugs, they hurt themselves, they boast about what base they've got to, they lie about what base they've got to. They make bets with each other about who can fuck you first. They choose the same lane as the girl with the best body so they can swim behind her and look at her underwater. They regret the times that they weren't unfaithful but could have been and got away with it. They make you sniff their unwashed hand the morning after they have fingered a girl for the first time. They think of as many words for penis as they can. They think of as many words for vagina as they can. They think of as many words for sexual intercourse as they can. They put their testicles on each other's heads. They say, you know what she needs. They say, dirty bitch. They say, yes, but did you have sex with him? They say, no, leave those on. They spit roast, they snog, they cuddle their pillows, they look at the girl they are fucking and try to imagine that it's porn. They take the piss out of virgins. They fly aeroplanes. They say, did I ask you to do that? They take their time. They read the news. They wait for their wives. They wait for their children. They wait for their chance. They wear tracksuits. They smoke pipes. They write fantasy novels. They go for a drink after work. They upgrade their computers. They keep in-jokes running for far too long. They start revolutions. They play rugby league, they carry things, they whistle a tune, they look at you funny. They say there's more where that came from. They deliberately give colleagues the wrong advice. They play war games, they read comics, they call them graphic novels. They sit in the front passenger seat. They blame the map. They exclaim whilst alone. They raise children. They fear change. They make excuses. They make weapons. They make things up. They sleep in tents. They play the drums. They tickle people. They make speeches. They go to board meetings. They use binoculars. They tuck their penis in between their legs and look at themselves in the mirror. They eat the last biscuit. They carve the roast. They imagine having sex with someone else. They cut down trees, they eat things off the floor, they spend the night in the cells, they do community service, they set light to things, they tend barbecues, they sigh, they tut, they faff, they make a fuss, they give up, they repeat themselves, they stand by the grave, they dig the allotment, they say, what do you do? They look into holes, they stroke the cat. You are 20 years old. You're moving into a shared house in a new city. It's a four-bedroomed house. Well, it's a three-bedroomed house, but the landlord has turned the front living room into an extra bedroom. You were the first person to move in. But within a week, two other guys have moved in. Three of the guys have moved in. Two of them are the same age as you. They're a bit older. And one guy is a bit younger. He's just 18 years old. And at first, you assume that it'll be the three of you who were the same age who get on the best, who become the closest friends. But somehow, that's just not what happens. The other three just gel that bit better as a group or a gang. They hang out in each other's rooms, listening to music. Some nights, they go to the pub, and they forget to invite you. One evening, 2 months into living in the house, you're in the kitchen. And the kitchen is the only shared room in the only communal room in the house. You're in there with Brett. Brett's one of the two older guys, and he's a rugby player. And Brett wants to talk to you about a friend of yours who's been visiting a lot recently and who's actually stayed over a couple of nights in the last week. And Brett wants to know if this guy is your boyfriend. So you say that yes he is. And Brett wants to know if that means that you're gay. So you say that yes you are. And as he's brought it up, you ask Brett if he's all right with that. And Brett says, yes, of course he is. Of course he's all right with it. Why wouldn't he be? The following evening, you're in the kitchen again, this time on your own, and you notice there are some new posters up on the kitchen wall. And these are pictures of famous young women wearing bikinis and underwear and nothing else. The following weekend, there's some extra things on the kitchen wall. These are lists, handwritten lists, of your housemate's top 10 most fanciable female celebrities, and lists of the girls who they have fucked whilst they've been in the house, with some extra details about what those girls let them do. From this point on, it's just that little bit more awkward in the house. Some nights, you come out of your room and you can hear the three of them talking in the kitchen, and you walk in, and it's silence. About a month later, Brett starts going out with a girl called Katie, and you and Katie hit it off really well, and she starts visiting a lot, and you think that this is maybe going to help, but somehow it feels like it just makes things worse. One weekend, Brett's parents come to visit, and Brett and his dad don't get on for some reason. There's a lot of tension there, but you're in the kitchen when they arrive, and you offer to make them a cup of tea, and you get talking to Brett's dad about music and architecture, and you hit it off really well, and Brett doesn't like that very much either. By the end of the year, relationships are pretty frosty in the house. But it's your birthday on the day before you're due to move out. So you decide you're going to have a party, and you tell your housemates, and they make sure that they are not around. You're all packed up and ready to leave. Your friends all come over, and you're all having a few drinks, and your friends know what your housemates are like. So they decide to make a few additions to the lists that are still up on the kitchen wall. They put the names of some male celebrities on the top 10 most fanciable lists, and they put Brett's name and the names of your other two housemates on the lists of people who have they've all shagged whilst they've been in the house. And you move out the next day. So you're not around to see what your housemates make of these jokes. And actually, you never speak to your housemates ever again. You still see them, you still live in the same city, you see them in the street or across the bar. But you barely acknowledge each other. Walking home from the pub and her getting on a bench and shouting it. I remember her waiting at the bottom of the escalator for me at the train station. I remember how she used to love it when I would lean forward across the pub table and kiss her in the middle of a conversation. I remember standing on the doorstep knocking on the front door even though she didn't know I was coming round. I remember her phoning late one night and saying, come round now. I remember her crying in the pub afterwards when she'd had a haircut. I remember her asking me to stay the night anyway. I remember getting where we were going in the car, but not getting out of the car because we had to finish the conversation. I remember playing her that record. I remember being able to smell her on the pillow the day after she'd stayed the night for the first time. You are 14 years old. You're sitting in the kitchen eating breakfast with your brother. Your mum comes into the kitchen and your mum is holding a towel in each hand. Your mum says, boys, I don't mind if you masturbate, but I do wish you would wash your towels more often. You don't look at your mum, you don't look at your brother, you don't finish your cereal, you get out of the kitchen, you get out of the house and you get down to school as quickly as possible so you can pretend that this never happened. You get home from school, you go into your bedroom. What your mum has done is she's washed your towel, she's ironed it, she's cut it into 12 smaller square towels, she's sewn at the edges so they don't fray, and she's put them in a neat pile on your bedside table. You hear your brother's voice behind you. Have you got a pile of these? Standing in your doorway holding his pile of towels. You say, yes, I have. He says, okay. And he goes away again. And the two of you do not talk about this again until you are much older and much drunker. When you do eventually talk about this, when you're in your mid-20s, both of you admit that neither of you could use them because you couldn't look at them without thinking of your mum. You are 22 years old. You're sitting in your living room with your wife and your three-year-old son, Jason. This is the first year that Jason has been Christmas aware, and he's very excited about the prospect of Father Christmas coming this evening and bringing him lots of presents. He's so excited, in fact, that he's being unusually difficult and naughty about going to bed. He's sitting in the middle of the carpet playing with his Lego. You tell him for the third time, Jason, it's time to put your Lego away because you should already be in bed. Jason carries on playing with his Lego as if he hasn't heard you. So Jason's mum has a go. Jason, I'm going to count to three. One, two, three. Still no response from the Lego department. So you get up, across the living room, you pick up the phone, but you only dial five digits. Hello, is that Santa? Hi, Santa. Yes, Mr. Stevens here. Yes, that's right, Jason's dad. Yes. Yes, he's been a very good boy all year. And until tonight, unfortunately. Well, he's not listening to us, and he's not putting his toys away, and he's not going to bed. Well, we were just planning to ask for your advice, really. Really? What? No presents at all? No. Yeah. Well, yes, you know best, Santa, of course. Right. Okay. Well, hopefully we'll see you next year. Thanks, Santa. Bye. And you put down the phone and you turn to see your son. And you see the tears streaming down his cheeks as he puts his Lego away. And you see him run from the room shouting that he's going to bed now. And you turn and you pick up the phone to phone Santa back and to tell him that maybe some presents would be in order, to do it in a voice loud enough for Jason to be able to hear from his bedroom, but it's too late. You already regret this. And you're going to go on regretting this for the rest of your life. In 20 years' time, you will still tell your friends that this was the worst thing you ever did as a father. So, I asked men, is football important? And men said, yes. Men said, yes, football is important because it lets me talk to strangers. You know, I could meet someone at a party or at a bus stop and we don't know each other, but we have something in common. We can talk about football. Men said, yes, football is important because it stops me being able to talk to other men, because as soon as other men find out I'm not interested in football, they just clam up. They don't know what else to talk about. Men said, yeah, football is important and it is a useful conversational tool at parties, but the problem happens, doesn't it, when you get talking to a guy at a party and it turns out he knows a lot more about football than you do, and you're just going to have to spend the next half an hour agreeing with him, because you realise that to admit to him that you were faking your level of interest in football and your knowledge about football would be an insult to both him and to yourself. What did Ben think? You get some sort of 2-for-1 offer on Italian food recently? Your mum and dad have been divorced for years now, and it occurs to you that this is quite an unusual situation for the three of you to be alone together. Your dad asks your mum how she is, and she tells him. Your mum asks your dad how he is, and he tells her. They say arthritis. They say back pain. They say hospital. They say appointment. They say symptom. They say remedy. They say prostate. They say ulcer. You don't say anything. You've known, you've understood for years now that at some point in the future your parents are going to die, and at whatever age you are when that happens, you'll be an orphan. But what you understand for the first time listening to this conversation is that before they die, your mum and dad are going to get old. They're going to become weaker and frailer. Less able to get about, less able to do things for themselves. They're going to need looking after by you. Notice when the people arrive and you stop thinking about this, at least for now. So, 27th of April, 1969, was a Sunday. You've all remembered that was my birthday, obviously. So, I'm Sunday's child. Now, depending on which version of the rhyme you know, that either makes me full of grace and fair and wise, or bonny and blithe and good and gay. Now, blithe, if you didn't know, I didn't, means sort of nonchalantly carefree. 27th of April. What star sign are you? I'm Taurus. That makes me lazy and stubborn, but also loyal and dependable in general. But you can go into astrology much deeper than that, you know. You can get a star chart done of the exact time and place of your birth, because the exact positions of all of the stars and the planets at the moment you are born has an effect on your personality, apparently. According to my star chart, done by my dad's friend Steve, at the moment I was born in Blockswich Maternity Home in Walsall in the West Midlands, the stars conspired to make me lazy, jealous, secretive, crafty, scheming, deceitful, inflexible, fickle, poor, although I don't see how poor is a personality trait, so, and they also gave me a fiery temper. But despite all of that, the stars also made me excellent for marriage and partnership. Probably because it was the stars that gave me my good looks. According to the Chinese calendar, I'm a rooster or a cock. That makes me a happy and radiant, wise and efficient. I'm a good problem solver. I am a bit of a perfectionist, but I'm a gossip. I'm contentious, I'm dogmatic even after I've been proven wrong, I'm sensitive to criticism because I am bloated with pride. Being a rooster, I will always leave an impression, but that impression could be of respect or disgust. Back at the big guy's face. and then he relaxes, and you feel the whole room relax with him, and then he sticks the pint glass into the big guy's face. You see the glass shatter. You see it start to cut into his flesh, and by then your body has turned itself away. You are 31 years old, and you work in a morgue. Your friends think that your job is weird, but you don't. You like your colleagues, and you enjoy the work. Your friends think that that is even weirder. You have the body lying in front of you on a metal trolley. You take the head, and you push it forward, and you get a headrest. A plastic one, if that's all there is left, but a wooden one is preferable. And you use that to keep the head in place with the chin down on the sternum. You pick up a comb and begin to comb the hair forward, cutting a parting in across the back of the head from one ear to the other. If the hair is long, you get a butterfly grip and you use that to hold it in place. You pick up a knife, a PM40, made in Sheffield. It looks like a butter knife, but it's actually more like a scalpel. You use your PM40 to cut along the line of the parting you've made across the back of the head. You're wearing gloves. You push your thumbs into the cut underneath the skin and you begin to peel the scalp off the skull, just like peeling an orange. And actually there is a layer of pith underneath the skin. This is the only bit of the job that sometimes you don't like, because if it's an old person with what you call cheap skin, it can tear and that feeling goes through you. But usually it's all right. And if it's a bald man, it's kind of fun. Once it's all loosened, you peel the skin forward down over the face until you can see the eyebrows on the skull. You take a tonga knife and you cut the muscles either side of the jaw. You pick up an air saw, which is harmless when it's not switched on, but once it's powered up, it can cut through bone, and that's what you need it to do. You cut around the top of the skull, being careful to cut two inverted V shapes on either side to allow you to key the skull cap back on later. You pick up a skull key, or if your boss isn't around, a chisel, because that gets better purchase in the cuts you've just made, and then you're able to simply pop the top of the skull off. Still wearing your gloves. You push your fingers through the membrane inside the skull and gently take the weight of the brain. You take a scalpel and you reach inside and you cut the two optic nerves. You reach further inside and you cut the spinal cord where it joins the cerebellum. And then you're able to remove the whole brain. If the body in front of you is an average male, the brain will weigh 1.35 kilograms. It will measure 140 millimetres wide by 163 millimetres long by 97 millimetres deep. The average male body is 178 centimetres tall and weighs 78 kilograms. It's a body mass index of 25, slightly overweight. Shoe size 43, blood type O. A resting heart rate when alive of 72 beats per minute. That's 2.86 billion heartbeats in a lifetime. A lifetime that will have lasted, on average, 75.7 years. The average male body is 43% muscle, 14% fat, 14% bone and marrow, 10% other internal organs, 9% skin and connective tissue, 8% blood. 2% brain.